Thank you, thank you. That was a very kind introduction, but I'm the smallest part of a very, very illustrious panel. And before I start the panel, I want to read a poem to you. Maybe some of it to keep you awake after lunch, but also to set the tone for what is going to happen today. And this is a very famous poem by Robert Frost. Some of you would have heard it or read it when you were children. It's called The Road Not Taken. Two roads diverged in a yellow wood, and sorry, I could not travel both. And be one traveler long I stood, and looked down on one as far as I could, to where it bent in the undergrowth. Then took the other as just as fair, and having perhaps a better claim, because it was grassy and wanted wear. Though as for that, the passing there had warned them really about the same. And both that morning equally lay in leaves no step had trodden black. Oh, I kept the first for another day, yet knowing how way leads on to way, I doubted if I would ever come back. I shall be telling this with a sigh somewhere ages and ages hence, two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference. So today we're going to talk about people who have taken the road less traveled. It's not always easy. It's often shunned by society, but it makes a huge impact to people, especially less privileged, and opens up our society's eyes to something that they would not have seen before. So it's my honor and privilege to invite the panelists. Can I invite Rahul Nainwal, my friend and young junior? Rahul used to be a terror in Hall 2 when we were there, but now is social entrepreneur. Rahul does some amazing work in social inclusion, which he's going to tell you about. I'm also delighted to invite on stage Manas Satpathy, badge of 1987. Manas bhai is a legend. Among the first, or many of the first Netrans who took a really important role in the social sector, has worked in Pradhan, one of the leading NGOs in the country. And finally, Sabyasachi Patra, badge of 1992. Sabyasachi, who I'll introduce more visually in some time, is a wildlife filmmaker, a person of real substance who's creating a flutter in society. So thank you, all of you. We'll have a rapid fire round, 20, 25 minutes. That's what Salil tells me, and we'll make the best use of it. So before I start, I think I'm going to think about one question which was coming to my mind, and just two or three sentences from each one of you. When you go back to the time when you graduated from college or were considering a career, was there one moment and you said, yes, you know, there is this two roads in front of me and I'm going to take the one less traveled? Aisa koi incident tha? Was there an event in your life which helped you make that choice? I was curious about that. Yeah, anybody? Rahul, you understand?
Yeah. So, hi. Thanks very much. So, I learned about Orissa after leaving Orissa. So, I went to a place called IRMA. It's called Institute of Rural Management, Anand. And at IRMA, I learned about these three places in Orissa called, they're popularly known as KBK, Koraput, Bolangir, and Kalahandi. Yeah. And there was an organization that had come to our campus from Kalahandi. It's called Gram Vikas. And their chief executive, Joe Madiyat, was speaking to a bunch of us. And he talked about, you know, the life of the tribals and how they are caught between, you know, mines and mining companies on one hand and guns on the other hand, and how their organization is actually doing some fantastic work over there. And he told us that in these places, there are a lot of foreigners who come and volunteer with us. So his statements were that there are a lot of Dutch hearts, there are a lot of British hearts that bleed for India. And when is that, some Indian hearts will also bleed for India. So for me, at least, I think that was really the defining moment for me, because I went to IRMA to, you know, get a job in an FMCG, Amul kind of a, you know, company. And at that point of time, I decided, no, I think if there's some hearts have to bleed for India, maybe, you know, I can start with mine. So this was really what changed me.
Fantastic. Manas. Yeah.
For me, it was like, you know, I never had thought of this, but my organization, Professional Assistance for Development Action Pradhan, was started by two individuals, one from IIT Delhi and IIM, and another from MIT Sloan School. So they had come to IIT. Actually, after an NIT, I was in government, and somehow I couldn't adjust myself there, so I went to IIT to do M.Tech. So there I met this group. So they selected me, still I didn't join, but one of my batchmates who joined came back and said, it would suit to your temperament, why don't you give it a try? Then I had gone there, and after seeing the work, I could realize that if my skills can be used to enhance the income and quality of life of such people who otherwise are ignored by the society. So I found some meaning in that. Before that, I think I had not decided anything till that time on my own. This is the only decision I think I have taken on my own to do this.
Actually, during engineering time, I had not thought that I should consciously follow a different path. I was like living a life that others kind of dictated, in the sense, whatever the society was deciding, that if you are good at studies, you should go for engineering. That's what I did. And if you are good at, I mean, if you are a great student in college, and if you are supposed to be successful, you have to get a good job. I got into Tata Motors, et cetera, et cetera. That's, and then there I realized people said, good guys go to MBA. Oh, yeah. I went into Exam Bhubaneswar. At that time, I had a fractured finger. I wrote in left hand, and I got into Exam Bhubaneswar. Anyway, so I worked in best of companies and all that. But the key moment came much later in life when I saw my dad in hospital in coma with a medicinally induced tears in his eyes. At that time, I realized that someday my time will also come. And if at that time my entire life comes across as a flashback passes in front of my mind's eye, then at that moment I might have regrets, and at that point of time I can never turn back the clock and go and do things which I wanted to do. So I decided that, that kept me thinking, brooding, thinking and introspecting, meditating and all that. And then that's how I decided that I have to follow the path that I want to choose for myself, which I really like. So that's how I have been into filming now. Not because the world thinks it is great. Well, I do a lot of wildlife filming. People think that it is really awesome and all that. But believe me, the kind of effort that you need to put, the days and days which you spend and without getting any results, you have to cry, all kinds of emotions you have to face. It's not an easy path. But that is one part of filming that I do. I talk about it. But other stuff, wildlife, corporate and all that, other films and all that promotions and all that I do, I don't talk about it. Because I learn a lot about wildlife, so any questions that you ask, I will answer from the perspective that I've gleaned from watching wildlife and the getting different kinds of inspirations and knowledges and all that I've got. That's all from wildlife. That's what I like.
So great. And that brings me to a question. Can we play a movie? Let's watch some of Sabyasachi's work. I thought it would be great to not just talk about it, but experience it. Can we play the short movie?
The Eastern Imperial Eagle is an amazing predator. It weighs between 2.45 kgs to 4.5 kgs. It is between 28 inches to 35 inches tall. On the other hand, the Indian Desert Fox weighs anywhere between 1.8 kgs to 3 kgs. It is an omnivore. It predates on rodents, gerbils, insects, as well as on fruits. So who will emerge victorious in this battle between the Eastern Imperial Eagle and Desert Fox? The Eastern Imperial Eagle tries to use its strength of attacking from the sky and tries to flush out the Desert Fox from the vegetation. But the Desert Fox tries to remain within the dense patch of forest. So the Eastern Imperial Eagle is forced to land close to the vegetation. The eagle tries to move step by step towards the Desert Fox to scare it away and push it to the open. The Indian Desert Fox, realizing its vulnerability in the open, dashes from one patch of the forest to the other. The Eastern Imperial Eagle can come down from the sky at a high speed using its massive wingspan of 5.9 feet to 7.1 feet and can use its talons and beak to inflict a death blow on the desert fox. In the bush, the Indian desert fox is agile. The fox can jump over vegetation, whereas the eagle can't fly within vegetation as its wings will get entangled. In that case, the predator will become prey. So here the Indian desert fox is choosing its battlefield based on its strength. So the Eastern Imperial Eagle has no choice but to land on its feet and come face to face with the desert fox. On the ground, they are staring at each other. The battle is now even. The massive wingspan advantage of the eagle is neutralized. The eagle made many attempts to flush out the desert fox from the bush. This went on for about half an hour, after which the Eastern Imperial Eagle decided to quit the battle. The cunning desert fox survived to live another day.
So tell us, Abhisarji, what can we learn from the fox and the eagle?
The reason I did it is like, now, always in during engineering, like, they used to ask questions, what is your strength, what is your weakness? And we used to ask people, yeah, kya likhna hai, weakness, strength mein? They used to say, guma ke likh do. And like, you just try to put it in different words and all that. And then during MBA days, like, we went through different kinds of models and all that. But then every time they used to say, oh, you are not a good marketing guy or you are not a good sales guy, so you have to work on your weaknesses, work on your weaknesses. Every moment, all that I heard is like, work on your weaknesses, work on your weaknesses. But then when I watch wildlife, I realize that they stick to their strengths. And then I realized, if you focus just on one single aspect, it's like, you know, you make it so strong. Whatever your services are, if you don't focus on your weakness, I mean, yes, there will be weaknesses. But if people realize that this guy can do X, Y, Z thing really, really well, so then it will not matter how you look like, what you do, where you stay, it doesn't matter. They will call you for that particular job. So let you be known for your strength, that X, Y, Z guy is really great, best in the world on X, Y, Z thing. Okay? So that will make a big difference. Rather than being jack of all trades kind of thing. So then nobody will know that, because otherwise then what happens, no? We are just a face in the crowd. Nobody knows. But if you really focus and make something really great, as something as your strength, then you stand out. Then people say, oh yeah, that guy, yeah, he is really good. On for XYZ thing, if you're in trouble, bank on him. That way. So that's what I realized, that people ignore their strengths. Work on your strengths to make it so great that you become like Arjuna. So that the moment you're firing a particular arrow, it will reach. So if an organization is depending on you, asking you to do something, then people will be assured that, yeah, something will happen. Or anybody worldwide, because today is an interconnected world. Anybody sitting in a village can offer his or her services. So and you can talk about it, how good, great, or you are in XYZ field. And the world can know. That's what they approach. So frankly speaking, I also get jobs from abroad based on my website and based on my stuff. So that's what you need to do. That's what Great. Is my humble opinion.
Thank you. That's a very useful message. And especially for those of us who have young children, and also for the Institute, that when we care for young children and young people and even older ones like us, it's important to focus on strengths. But I want to come back to you, Rahul. I think... Oftentimes, poor people are considered the weakest among society. And what Rahul, some of you should study his work, he has a terrific TED talk. He's running a completely outrageous and audacious experiment, giving direct cash and lots of it to a few poor people. So tell us what you've learned about working with people who society labels as the weakest, and what have been the surprises?
So I think, on the contrary, poor people are probably the most strongest, because they are able to survive with very, very little. You know, so they are like, yep, I would call them, you know, experts of of poverty alleviation. And the situation in the sector is that we hardly kind of listen to them. So they are not sitting in conferences. They are not doing any, you know, shaping policy around how we should do poverty alleviation. So for instance, in the work that we do in Udaipur district is where we are giving to each in a village to about 34 families. We have given them about 1 lakh rupees each now for free. So we are not going to ask this money back. So when we go to people and people say, oh, this is really foolish because, you know, if you give money to people for free, they will drink, right? Or they will do something, you know, foolish with it. But our research has actually shown that almost 100% of these people have actually put this money into some productive asset, or they have leveled their farms, or they have, you know, dug a bore well. So they have used this money for really, really productive asset. And why are people poor? People are poor because they have no money. So rather than having a system where some foreign agency will pay a consultant like me to figure out what poor people need and give it to them, just believe that poor are also intelligent and they have a lot of strength. Just give all this money straight to them. I think.
And what happened when you gave the money straight to them?
So what happens when you give money straight to them is that they then can decide what are their needs and they can put that money to that need rather than me deciding for a lot of them. Just like in this room, if I were to decide just one or two things for everybody, it'll be foolish, right? So similarly, in a context of a village also, if one person decides what everybody will need, then that is really foolish. So you give money to the people who actually need it and let them decide. Have faith that they will put this money to good use. So this is an initiative called Cash Relief, and I would really request you to kind of look it up on the internet. But there is another thing I want to kind of, you know, point out here, that in social sector and in life generally, you know, we have kind of big words. So for instance, one big word is that we are very developed and intelligent, and poor people or the tribals are not intelligent. They are not civilized. So I'm coming from these small district called Dangs in Gujarat, if you have heard of Dangs. Now, Gujarat is a very, very forward-looking state, right? Everybody knows that Gujarat's model of development and all that. You would be surprised, in a very developed district in Gujarat called Mehsana, the male-to-female sex ratio is about 870. And this is a very developed district. You know, everybody is intelligent, everybody has money. So of 1,000 men, only 872 women are born. Can you guess what is this number for Dangs? Dang has 1,004. So then who is intelligent? Who is civilized? Who is developed? So should we be bringing development from Mehsana to Dangs, or we should be transporting development and intelligence and civilization from Dangs to Mehsana? So this is really the contradiction that we, you know, as social sector workers, we see, you know, across in various parts of our country. So one has to be really, really careful about, you know, being an expert, you know, not listening to the people, doing policy making, sitting somewhere in air conditioned rooms and all.
No, that's a useful lesson, and I wish you all success. Sabri Sachi, you have been the longest in this battle, right? What has kept you going? You know, sometimes people tell us that working in the social sector is extremely frustrating, it can tire people out. So what has kept you in there for such a long time? Sorry, Manas, sorry.
Yeah. What has kept me here? See, first initial days when I could use my skills to enhance the quality of life of people in such interior villages, that certainly was quite inspiring and that made me continue. But when I continued and interacted with many other stakeholders, when I saw that they also have a heart, even though they are not able to reach the village, they really want to support such initiatives. And one of our senior friends who is here, an administrator from Odisha, he also, when he saw our work, Madhusudan Padhi, he really extended unique support. He came general way, he came out to support that work. And in a district like Kandhamal, if you have heard of, one of the poorest district in the country, we had done natural resource management work to improve income of people, and that was a riot time when there was a difference going on between SC and ST community. We focused on livelihoods and we could address those issues, and all of them came together to work on it, improve their natural resources and improve income. So down the line, we could reach out to many more stakeholders all the new corporates are after this new CSR Act. They are also after knowing about our work. They are taking interest and coming forward to work with us in such interior pockets. Because our strategy is to reach those pockets where the impact of our unprecedented economic growth is minimum. So we have identified such 11 poorest clusters across this central India, and we are trying to make a difference there. Great.
And you know, often I'm met by people who work in the corporate world or doing other things, which is very rewarding, and they often tell me, yeah, you know, I always want to work in the social sector. Should I not? Or do something interesting or creative, should I not? What would be your one line of advice to someone who's considering this change after you've gone through this journey yourself, maybe starting with Sabyasachi?
See, one thing is, first thing I'll not name a person, but then one of my friends, in fact, a couple of my friends, they became entrepreneur and then left it, and one of them said, yaar, ye passion vision kuch nahi hota hai, bakwas hai. Okay, so the thing is, today passion is the buzzword. That doesn't mean that suddenly you will think, I will quit my job and try to find out what exactly is my passion. Then, so what happens is people have become so unidimensional, so it becomes very difficult to understand what is their passion. So I would like to tell people, first find out what you're good at or what you have been doing consistently. For example, in my past life when I was doing strategic consulting and all that, one of the consulting models is like known as emergent consulting. Emergent strategy. That model means that the organization has been doing something consistently over a period of time, and when they look back, they see a common thread. So that becomes their strength. So if an organization is focused on particular thing, X, of say quality or whatever, so they have become the best quality company in the world or best customer service company in the world or something like that, because over a period of time that becomes an organization culture. So that becomes their strength. So you as a person, as an individual, if you want to do something, just don't jump into it because the entire world is jumping. Don't get into that herd mentality kind of thing. You have to first explore and find out what is there within. Please understand that if you believe that God has made us, like, and perhaps God has made us for a purpose, try to find out what is the purpose in your life, or whether God has made a mistake in creating you. I mean, prove it that God has made a mistake. So what I'm saying is, try to figure out what exactly you have within, because people focus on saying that, oh, Anushtup is great, he has done something, let me also do something, get into education. No, that's not what is your strength. You focus on your strength. You figure out what exactly is within you. Find out what is your spirit, and if at all there is a spirit which you have caged within you, uncage it. Let that spirit come out. Discover yourself. So to discover yourself, go and then introspect. Be there in the market. Be there in nature. Try to keep your eyes and ears open and not fiddle on the WhatsApps and other stuff. Look at people. You might see something. You might see what people are doing. You might see something great. You might get a spark. Once you get a spark, start focusing on it, introspecting on it. And then you'll get more truths. That spark will become a burning fire. Burning fire will become really raging forest fire. Then you know that, yes, this is something which nobody understands, and this will change the world or whatever. So let me focus on it. That becomes your motive, that becomes your goal, that becomes your passion. That's the life you will continue to lead. I mean, that's how you will focus on. Find out what is that. Find out that spark. Just don't jump into it.
A sentence from you, Rahul and Manasvi. Yeah, Manasvi.
So I would like to say that we are talking about this inclusive growth all the time. But poverty is always there, and we need to understand that poverty is not God's creation, it is society's creation only. Because it's an outcome of deliberate effort to establish inequitable distribution of power, wealth, and opportunity in the society. So unless these are addressed, income enhancement will not address it. And we are talking about Millennium Development Goals, now we are talking about Sustainable Development Goals, and zero poverty is the target. Zero poverty cannot be achieved unless we who have something more knowledge, whatever wise. We need to be available to others so that inclusive growth is focused. And like already our friends have talked about capability, they also have the capability. But the micro environment they have faced since their childhood always have given them a sense that they are incapable, they are not knowledgeable, and like that. So once you trigger the potential that they have, like we have the experience, any activity we have introduced with the most tribal community, poultry, they have achieved the industry standard. Tusser sericulture, they have achieved the industry standard. They have rather crossed the standard, and CSB then revised the standard, Central Silk Board, after seeing their results. So capability-wise, they are no less. But from their childhood, they have given a sense that they are less human, lesser human beings. So that we need to address, and then they can do the rest.
Rahul?
So I think I would like to focus first on why somebody should not come into the social sector. Okay. So pehle toh, I think, अगर लोग सोच रहे हैं कि मुझे रिटायर होने के लिए आना है, कि या मैंने कॉर्पोरेट सेक्टर में काफी काम कर लिया है, बहुत थक गया हूं मैं टारगेट्स को मीट करते करते, चलो अभी कहीं पार्किंग करते हैं सोशल सेक्टर में जाके, तो किसी एनजीओ को ज्वाइन कर लेंगे. सो ये तो आई थिंक इज द वर्स्ट रीजन टू कम टू द सोशल सेक्टर, बिकॉज सोशल सेक्टर डज नॉट नीड वॉर्म बॉडीज. सो वी नीड पीपल हु हैव स्किल्स टू ऑफर, हु आर प्रॉब्लम सॉल्वर्स. सो दीज आर द पीपल हु आर नीडेड इन द सोशल सेक्टर. एक और आदमी आ जाएगा जो एक सीट पर बैठेगा और कुछ करेगा, दैट इज वॉट इज नॉट नीडेड. सो दिस इज वन. I think the second is that if you think you are coming to the social sector because you want to discover yourself, don't come. Art of Living का 3 दिन का course है, ठीक है? और तो आप वो course कर सकते हैं, आप अपने आप को discover कर सकते हैं. और तीसरा, अगर if you are earning a lot of money, ठीक है, you've earned a lot of money by, you know, by kind of giving your skills, and you are feeling guilty. तो डोनेट कर दीजिए यार, ठीक है? आप डोनेट करिए किसी स्पेशलिस्ट ऑर्गेनाइजेशन को और थोड़ा हैंड्स ऑफ उनको हेल्प करिए. उसके बाद जंप करके कि अब मैं आपकी स्ट्रेटजी ड्राइव करूंगा, सब कुछ करूंगा बिकॉज आई हैव गिवन यू दिस मनी, तो ये भी मत करिए.
ग्रेट, थैंक यू सो मच. इट्स
एक पॉइंट मेरा और
एक ही सेंटेंस, बिकॉज सलील इज गोइंग टू कम आफ्टर मी.
व्हाई पीपल शुड जॉइन द सोशल सेक्टर इज दैट इफ दे सी ग्रेट इनजस्टिसेस अराउंड देम, if they see a problem that needs to be solved, they should come and jump into the sector, because here you will get opportunities to solve some real complex problems. And the second reason why you should come and join us is that if you have really hard skills to contribute, if you think you can really make a difference to a particular organization because you're really good in, let's say, enterprise systems and all of that, or you're a good problem solver, or you're a good finance guy, you can do great fundraising, then you should come and join. And last but not the least, do remember hamari salaries 1/3 या हाफ होंगी आपकी जितनी होंगी, ठीक है? तो वो भी थोड़ा ध्यान रखिएगा. अगर आपकी EMIs रनिंग है, आपके बच्चे स्कूल में है, इंजीनियरिंग कॉलेज की डोनेशन देनी है कहीं पे, या US भेजना है, तो थोड़ा सोच समझ के आइएगा.
थैंक यू वेरी मच. दैट वॉज एन एनलाइटनिंग पैनल एंड आई हैव नो वर्ड्स टू समराइज, बट आई थिंक व्हाट आई एम टेकिंग अवे इज passion is not enough. What we also need is dispassion. And I want to abuse my privilege of sharing my own journey. This journey could not have happened if there was not one person who I had met, and this person happens to be sitting in this room. It's kind of by great fortune. You don't do outrageous things unless you meet outrageous people. For someone like me, who had a pretty middle class existence and checking all the boxes in a middle class life, had I not met Priyadarshi Mahapatra, who is sitting in this room, who is the most outrageous person I have met, I don't think I would have done half the things I would have done in my life. So thank you for being the Hatke person in my life. Thank you very much for being such a patient audience. We move on to the next order of business.
I have just one thing to
request.
Yes,
but let that
to
be.
To our director in IT, Tata has supported MIT to establish a center, that is Tata MIT Center. The objective of that center is to engage MIT students in solving the problems of rural community in India to start with. They may go to other countries afterwards. So can our NIT start that kind of a center? Because we are going all the way to MIT to get their students to know rural problems and come up with new technologies to solve their problems. Can we have? So let us have it in NIT and let us make it a system for our NIT students to really engage with rural communities and come up with new technologies to solve their problems.